This is the most revolutionary mobile product launch that I ever remember. These new laptops make a lot of their more expensive competition not worth buying anymore. I'll leave timestamps in the description as well, but I strongly suggest you to watch the whole video because I'll cover absolutely everything you need to consider in order to make an exceptional purchase decision, or if you just want to stay updated to the latest trends. Knowledge is everything. So make sure to subscribe not to miss all this valuable information. Up until yesterday, Intel was uncontested when it came to laptop CPUs. Today, AMD completely flips the script and their 4000 CPUs are by all metrics.
What if I want to use my CPU as a room heater?
Almost all meaningful metrics, the best CPU for laptops, period. That means that AMD today closes the consumer circle and it now offers the best products for desktop, workstation, and laptop alike. Let that sink in for a moment. And this is significant because the laptop market is far bigger than desktop. We are talking approximately 165 million units versus 90 million units. This is the ultimate underdog story. AMD worked with a fraction of Intel's budget. Sure, AMD is fabless and Intel has many more products, but even if we were to add to that number TSMC R&D spending, which is the company that actually manufactures the silicon, still the numbers seem to be in Intel's favor. If that doesn't make you feel that everything is possible, I don't know what could. So let's have a look at AMD mobile lineup, shall we? The U targets thin and light laptops that can dissipate from 10 to 25 watts, while the H targets more powerful machines that range from 35 to 45 watts of power dissipation. The 35 watt series gets the HS name, and for the most part, those CPUs seemed binned variations of the H series that perform more efficiently. The only exception being the 4900H and the 4900HS that seem to have a clock difference from each other. I think the reason for that might be that the binning is already pushed with those parts that already seem to be golden samples. For that reason, I don't see the 4900HS not performing pretty much the same as a 4900H if they're put in the same thermal envelope. Keep in mind that Asus has a 6-month exclusivity for the HS lineup, so you will not be able to find those processors in any other brand for half a year. So how good is this 4900HS? Well, it destroys the best mobile 9th gen Intel CPU. And it completely puts it to shame when it comes to power efficiency. I kinda was expecting AMD to be more efficient than Intel by looking at the desktop situation. In fact, the performance per watt in Cinebench R20 of the AMD 16-core 3950X is approximately double the one of the Intel's top offering 9900K. For me, that's enough to not even consider Intel's desktop parts. Enough to say that the efficiency of AMD's new mobile parts even exceeded my expectations, and that's so critical in laptops, not only for the obvious advantages for battery life, but also it determines the type of work you can do with a certain form factor. The most interesting laptop of all the upcoming confirmed ones that achieves just that is the Asus Zephyrus G14. This is a very compact and light laptop that houses 8 cores and a dedicated GPU. Its thermal design is a work of art. Seriously, Apple, take notes, and whoever designed this really did a phenomenal job. They managed to put 7 heat pipes in this chassis. To further emphasize the efficiency of this CPU, these laptops manage to get 10 hours of battery life when doing light tasks. What? That's insane. Who is this laptop for? First, I need to mention a couple of things. This laptop doesn't have a webcam, Thunderbolt 3 support, and the backlight illumination for the keyboard is very bad. Even though I personally prefer 1440p or higher on a 14-inch screen, I would advise everyone not to consider the top $2,000 configurations. $550 for the 1440p upgrade is really too much. In fact, you can get a very nice external screen for that price. And second, those configurations forces you into adopting the anime animation matrix. Sure, it transforms your laptop into a meme machine, but for me personally, adding 2 millimeters of thickness and 9 watts of power consumption is overall something I would rather not have. If Asus in the future were to add the 1440p upgrade by its own at a reasonable $150 price, it would be well worth it in my opinion. The difference between CPUs in the different configurations is negligible and will likely be less than 5%. Either CPU option is good. And the other thing is RAM. Seems that all the models come with 8 GB of soldered RAM, and the 16 GB version come with the only SODIMM slot populated with an 8 GB stick. To me, this halfway approach makes little sense. Since we're dealing with dual channel memory, leaving the SODIMM slot empty will grant you a huge performance penalty. And the best thing to do is to match the soldered RAM frequency and CL latency with your SODIMM module. Otherwise, the performance of your computer adjusts to the slowest of the two. And really, unless you want to put asymmetrical size modules that will get you to 24 gigabytes, you're really forced into just one option. So in my opinion, it would have been better and simpler for the consumer for Asus to just go all the way with soldier memory and reap the full benefits of size reduction. So when referring to the base configuration, I will add $70 for the cost of good 3200 MHz RAM. For those of you who are budget conscious, I should also mention that Asus also make the tough A15 with Ryzen 4000H processors. Its design is less refined and more utilitarian. It also looks a little bit more gamery. It's definitely less portable and the screen has a narrower color gamut. On the flip side, it's cheaper, you get a little bit more performance, has a webcam, a numpad, 2 DIMM slots where you can install up to 32 gigabytes of RAM, and the possibility of choosing between a bigger battery or having the possibility to install an additional M.2 NVMe SSD and a 2.5-inch drive. But let's get back to the Zephyrus. So let's start with gamers, since this is who this device is marketed to. Let's get this immediately out of the way. The 120Hz screen has over 40 milliseconds of combined gray-to-gray response times, and that translates to ghosting. If you want this for competitive esports and you want to play on the laptop screen, I would suggest you to go and look elsewhere. Also, there is no Thunderbolt 3, so there is no chance to connect an external GPU. Having said that, if you don't need a very high-end GPU and you play at home with an external screen and you need a portable device on which to do other type of work as well, this is an excellent option. Your configuration of choice should be dictated by the GPU and what type of resolutions or frame rates you want to achieve. I'm a big fan of the base configuration with the GTX 1650, and in fact it has great value for 1080p gaming. But if you want to step up a notch, the sweet spot really is in the $1,300 configuration. That grants you about a 30% graphics improvement. $1,450 gets you an RTX 2060 Max-Q and about a 15% improvement, and it's not that bad either, considering that you get another 500 gigabytes of storage as well. But keep in mind that performance varies greatly from game to game, so if you want to make the most optimal decisions for you, make sure to check some benchmarks that include your titles. Let's move on and consider what I think is the perfect demographic for the Zephyrus: architecture and engineering students as well as professionals. This machine is an exceptional choice for those who want a relatively inexpensive, very portable laptop. If your work involves CAD, CAM or CAE, 3D modeling, rendering or simulations, really there are no other better options at this price range, let alone that offer the same portability. Speaking of CAMs, if you're a CNC machinist, you know how expensive it is to drill all the small holes into the upper chassis. Even though CADs are generally heavily single-threaded, these CPUs are almost on par of the best of what Intel has to offer. If you use computer-aided engineering and simulation, really the multi-threaded performance of the 4900HS is absolutely the best that you can find in a laptop, period. And I'm sure many, many professionals will find this laptop suitable for their work. Just make sure to find some benchmark on your particular applications, because the performance of gaming GPUs vary greatly from software to software and are dependent on your particular workload as well. For example, Siemens NX and Autodesk Inventor perform way better on workstation cards, especially if you use wireframes. If you really want a further step in performance, you really have no other option than building a desktop or going for a much heavier, much more expensive portable workstation with Nvidia Quadros or AMD WX professional line of cards. So now on to the configurations. If budget is important, I think the base is actually an amazing choice. The mid-range is a good step up, mainly because it gives you that 6GB of GDDR6 graphics memory. A faster GPU can also speed up renderings. If $150 makes you little difference, and if you also value the added 500GB of storage, sure, pick the best. Let's now consider video editors. If you also have a 4K color accurate display at home or in your office, this is such a great machine. And in mobility, the color accuracy of this laptop screen is definitely enough for the majority of content targeted at online visualization. The only thing that you might be missing is a 4K screen option. There is a 1440p overpriced one, but definitely on the Intel side of things, for the moment, there is a much wider choice. For the configurations, I think the sweet spot is the $1300 one. If budget is not of particular consideration, or you added 6K, well, definitely the RTX 2060 Max-Q will naturally be better. Make sure to be able to afford a good external monitor before considering this upgrade. If your budget is very limited and you work with 1080p footage, then the base model will certainly serve you well. And when it comes to software developers, unless you work with Android Studio or do other computational intensive stuff, or you work with external screens all the time, then I think there are really other better options for you at the moment. You will likely have less benefits from the amazing computational performance of these laptops as much as you would have from a high resolution screen where you can fit more code and more reference material. So we had a look at the Zephyrus, but what if you don't need a dedicated GPU? This generation, both Intel and AMD bring to the table very impressive integrated graphics performance that actually surpass entry-level dedicated GPUs. From the confirmed upcoming 4000U series laptops without a dedicated graphics card, there are two interesting options: the Lenovo Yoga Slim 7 and the Acer Swift 3. Lenovo, to my eyes, seem to have a more premium design, while the Acer seems to be more affordable as it also has cheaper configurations available. The pricing for the Lenovo Yoga Slim 7, though, seems to be starting at $850, and that's just $200 lower than the base Zephyrus. And mind the gap, the closeness to the G14 price is not a comfortable spot for the Lenovo to be in. Still, for many, there are several advantages of not having a dedicated GPU. Battery lasts much longer, and the thermal design can be more forgiving, and that allows for slimmer and lighter laptops. So, these laptops are for you if you want general good all-rounders, school and university, office work of course, media consumption, and some light gaming. Also, for 1080p video editing, if you really can't stretch your budget to a base Zephyrus, this is your next best thing. Let's wrap up and see who is, right now, left out of the performance benefits of the Ryzen 4000 series. So the first huge group is Apple users. And since we're focusing on mobile for this video, the $1300 Zephyrus configuration outperforms the $2600 excellent MacBook Pro 16-inch one. Granted that the Mac has better screen, an overall more refined design, way better audio, exceptional microphones, and I guess having a terrible webcam is better than having no webcam at all. With this product launch, to me, the only reasons to choose a Mac right now are either you need a software that is available only on macOS, or of course, if you simply really like macOS or one of their computers. Keep in mind that in that case, you're not mindful of both the performance per cost metric as well as squeezing out the most performance you can out of a certain form factor. This also applies to a lot of Windows laptops at the moment. For now, there are no really premium boutique laptops announced, but at least for the Surface lineup, I think it's basically a given that Microsoft will feature the 4000 series in their next product updates. And I wouldn't be surprised that Dell, HP, Lenovo would do the same very soon. These laptops come with perks that might be more significant to some people than raw performance. I'm talking about high resolution or very color accurate screen, exceptional build quality and design. I would also add for the moment the gamers that need a very high refresh, low response time screen or an even higher end GPU than the RTX 2060 Max-Q in this category. So other than some other very niche cases such as rugged laptops for example, these are right now the features that are missing from the Ryzen 4000 series laptop offerings. And if we look at Intel's competition and we glimpse a little bit into the future, I don't really see the 10th gen H series to really change that dominant position that AMD occupies. And I honestly hope I'm wrong, because competition always makes things so much more exciting. But it seems that until Tiger Lake, which is rumored to become available in Ultrabooks at the end of the year, I only see things getting better for AMD as more and more manufacturers adopt their chips into their products. And whenever a laptop is offered in both the red and blue flavors, the better choice will be obvious. So if you found this video helpful, don't forget to smash the like button and subscribe for more content like this.
So, Lisa Su, what do you say?
Subscribe.
Subscribe.